This is Rob Howden, the voice of the Mazda Road to Indy, and you're listening to the Indy Sports Car Podcast.
Welcome, ICP fans, to another episode of the Indy Sports Car Podcast. Hey, Missy.
Hello, hello. And joining us tonight, we have the winner of the third annual Mazda Road to Indy USF 2000 $200,000 scholarship shootout, Hunter McElrea. Welcome to the show, Hunter.
Thanks, guys. Happy to be part of it.
Hunter, it's a pleasure to have you on, sir. And congratulations on basically, I should say welcome to the family. Welcome to the Road to Indy family. Mazda Road to Indy family? I don't know. Welcome to the open wheel, American open wheel family. There you go. That's what I'm going to say right now.
Thank you. Thank you.
Go, Missy.
Go, Missy. Got it. So, Hunter, tell us a little bit about yourself, like where you started out, what ranks you came through, and how you wound up in the Mazda Road to Indy shootout, scholarship shootout.
So pretty much, way back, I started out like most people do, just with go-karts. So my dad was really busy, so I didn't really get to do it much. Like when I was really young, like I'm talking probably 7 years old, 8 years old, I kind of went out like twice a year. And did like literally, I was that like dude at the back of the field rolling around so slowly, but I was loving it. And it was just fun for me. So that pretty much was like my karting career. I moved up the ranks a little bit when I got kind of 13, 14, 15. Like I had an opportunity to do it at a high level a bit more frequently. And like, I got some good results on like a national level in Australia, but you know, I never really was properly a go-karter, I guess you could say. So I moved up to Formula 4, and that's when I kind of started racing probably like the most frequently, I guess you could say, and properly. And just started out in Australia on a state level, and then like did pretty well straight away. And then, you know, just worked my way up kind of in the national level. And in Australia, we have the Australian Formula 4 Championship, and it's pretty much the most competitive junior category over here. Like there's probably on average 25 to 30. Cars, like really, really fun. Like in America, I think you guys call it Formula 1600, right?
Yes.
Yes.
Yeah. So it's like similar. Like it's a My Gale car, so it's the same chassis and things like that. But we run a proper, like a real groove tire, and it's called a Ford Duratec engine. So it's got a little bit more horsepower than the cars over in the US. But anyway, that was really cool. So I did that for 2 years. In 2017,
I'm sorry. I was just reading here, part of Krista Hardy's article about you. 13 wins out of 21 races last year. Wow.
Yeah. Thanks. It was a real good season. To be honest, like a few wins slipped away as well, but obviously, you know, it was a really good season in terms of like statistics and things like that. Like we got so many wins and poles and fastest laps and things like that, but it wasn't as straightforward as it kind of looked on paper, because it was like a few times like I was unlucky in one stage, but you know, kind of to sum it up quickly, I got a few penalties which were pretty hefty in points penalties. So obviously I was leading the championship, and
what were the penalties?
So I got penalized. Like I made a mistake in a race once, and basically just literally stuffed up and took myself out, and then another person, unfortunately, as well. Obviously, like I 100% take the blame for that. And that was a points penalty. And then there was another instance where I got another points penalty as well. So they were my only two penalties for the year, but you know, it reflected really heavily. So I kind of to put it in perspective, like a race win was 20 points, And I think I probably had over 2 race wins and points penalties taken away from me.
Oh, geez.
Like, basically, my nearest championship rival would have, literally, I would have DNF'd and he would have won 2 races in points penalties. That was kind of how it worked out. But hey, you know, like, I learned from it. And, you know, 100% take the blame and learn my lesson, I guess you could say. But yeah, anyway, I went into the last round. And obviously, like you said, like, we had a really, really strong season. But between me and my rival, it went down to the last race. So
that's awesome.
Like, it wasn't very relaxed at all, I can tell you that much. Like, and I actually, you know, the last race ended up with a little bit of contact between me and him. So I actually ended up getting sent in the air. And yeah, it was very, very close and stressful, but you know, we got there in the end, and that's what matters, I guess.
Yeah, I mean, you know, these you know, the Formula Ford and then the USF 2000 and coming up, I mean, you know, I mean, you're supposed to kind of screw up there, and that's where, you know, that, I mean, you're there to learn. And I mean, I don't know about you, but I don't learn anything unless I screw it up pretty bad. So.
Oh, for sure. No, that's it, right? Like, it's a junior formula. Like I said, we had a mega season and we got the championship win. But like, there was plenty of times where I made mistakes and learned from it. And basically, I think that's the whole point of it. Like, if you're not pushing the limits sometimes and learning from your mistakes, you're not going to move forward. But in saying that, you don't really want to be making mistakes every weekend, I can tell you that much. But I think definitely it's prepared me well for going into the season, because I'm kind of in a position where, you know, these guys in USF 2000, they're not going to be making many mistakes. Like, they're all extremely quick and talented drivers. So yeah, I'm really excited to be part of the Road to Indy. But yeah, really, really happy to look back on a pretty awesome career over here.
I mean, it definitely sounds like you've had a very interesting road, you know, on your way over to here. I mean, wait till St. Pete, man. The first lap of St. Pete.
Yeah. I've seen some footage, funnily enough. Like, and obviously it's rolling starts, which is something that I haven't really had much experience with at all. But obviously it's standing starts over here, which is what I've always done in my career so far. But
right.
I've seen some, like, first lap antics, and it seems like in the USF 1000 race last year and the Pro Mazda race, like, there was one guy that just sent it in the inside in the dust and stuff, and he went straight ahead. So yeah, I guess, you know, time will tell, but yeah, it looks like it's definitely gonna be pretty exciting.
It always is, like, and it's every year. If, you know, you can go back the last 5 years, and every year there's something interesting happening.
Yeah, for sure.
Yes, that race is not going to be won in the first turn of the first lap. So,
nah.
Yeah, I mean,
exactly.
And they really test you guys on a street course for your first race of the season too, because you can't. I mean, you make a mistake, those walls are unforgiving. I mean, there's a few runoffs, but not many.
Yeah, that's a new experience to me too. Obviously, I've never driven a street track yet, so. That's going to be a pretty sweet and cool experience for me as well. Like, I'm really looking forward to just getting on track and experiencing that. But yeah, it's going to be really fun and can't wait.
I mean, and ovals for that matter as well, right?
Yeah, for sure. So there's going to be a lot of new experiences this year, which I'm looking forward to. So yeah, I just can't wait to get going.
Right on.
Do you do any, like, simulation racing to try and get familiar with the tracks that you're going to be going
yeah
to?
Like, I like going on the sim. It's pretty fun. Like, I've got in my room at home, like, nothing fancy, I just got a little rig I've kind of, like, put together. But I like going on iRacing a little bit, and just, you know, like, it's fun with your mates. Like, I've got a few mates who race over here and, you know, in other spots around the world. And we'll like, you know, we'll do something random. Like, I'm talking sometimes even an MX-5 around, for example, Road Atlanta last night. Like, we were doing an MX-5 around Road Atlanta, and it was literally, like, the World Championship. Like, it was all on. So that was heaps of fun. But, you know, there's a they just bring out the Formula 3, and that's heaps of fun. So I've been doing that a little bit, the Formula 3 on racing. But, yeah, I like doing sim. I think it's a pretty good tool, and especially, you know, learning new tracks next year, it's probably going to help a lot. So, yeah, sim's good.
Yeah, I'm going to have to send you a friend request a little after the show. I just got my new wheel in the mail, thank God.
No way. What'd you get?
I got the Fanatec Porsche GT3 RS wheel.
Damn.
It's a bit of a throwback.
Nice.
My old wheel, you know, like the paddle shifters didn't work anymore, and then the motors in it started humming real bad, so I got a new one in the mail, and this one's real nice. I got to hook it up still though. So
is that a Fanatec?
Yeah.
So they replace it for free? Because it's like my friend, his like base, like something broke in it, and he literally sent it to Fanatec for free, and they fixed it and sent it back to him like at no charge. So,
They wouldn't do it because it was a discontinued model.
Oh, okay.
Because this thing literally is probably, I think, I think they discontinued it back when I first got it, probably like 4 years ago. So that's what I mean. Like it you know, like the new bases, you know, you can change out the wheels and everything.
Nice.
Yeah, like this one you can't. This one is straight up a Porsche wheel. It's got, you know, the yellow metal band in the middle of it. It's got a nice suede wheel and a lot of nice buttons to it. The thing's beautiful.
Yeah, it's so good. So, nice.
But I mean, yeah.
Add me on iRacing for sure. Send the request or whatever, and yeah.
Right on.
We'll do some laps.
Sounds good, man. Sounds like fun. Excuse me. All right. So, and, but when you come over here, definitely head over to, over in Indy. It's in the same, it's in the same building as Pit Fit, training. It's called,
No way.
Yeah. It's called, Missy, help me out here. I always forget the name of it.
And it's called Racecraft One.
There you go. Yeah, it's called Racecraft One.
Racecraft One. Okay.
Ask for Christian.
Yeah, he's our.
He'll hook you up.
Yep. He's our other co-host, Christian. Yeah, and he works there. St. Pete is there, so you can get some sim work on going on St. Pete, because really there's no other sim that has it. So they have every track that you'll see in the USF 2000 season that's not on iRacing,
like Mega.
St. Pete, I think, is one, and I think maybe Toronto is another one that they have that you can't get anywhere else. So yeah.
Oh, cool. Yeah, I'll have to have a look at that then.
Right on. So, out of all the new, you know, you're going to be racing road now. Is Road America, Elkhart Lake, is that like a world renowned kind of a track? Like, have you heard of it before?
Oh yeah, for sure, man. Like, Road America is so cool. I've watched so many races from there, and like, it's obviously going to be one of those things. Like, you tick it off the bucket list when you go there. As you know, going to Indy for the first time for me, that was unreal. And even just, you know, like I said, being a part of the IndyCar paddock, it still doesn't really feel like it's real, I guess you could say. Like, something that I've personally been working towards for so long. So to be, like you said, racing at tracks like Road America,
Missy,
all the tracks, it's so cool.
Yeah, so what's the one track you're looking, most forward to?
It's hard, because they're all such cool tracks. Like, I couldn't pick out one in particular. Like, I'm obviously looking forward to Road America. Laguna Seca is going to be amazing. Indy, the street tracks, all of them. It's like, I can't pick one. But for sure, it's going to be pretty amazing racing at Laguna and Road America for the first time. That's going to be really cool to tick off the list.
Well, I mean, I'll tell you, Mid-Ohio, I think, will surprise you the most as far as a track that you didn't expect that you'll fall in love with. I'm telling you right now.
Yeah, Mid-Ohio as well. Sorry, I missed that. That's going to be so cool. Like, I've done it I've done like 10 laps on it on a simulator at the moment, and I was like, man, this is so cool. Like in a car like a USF 2000 or any of the RTI cars, like obviously Pro 2000, Pro Indy 2000, sorry, and Indy Lights, it would just be so cool, obviously, with the slicks narrow through all those like undulating and flowy corners. So that's going to be so cool.
Yeah, definitely. I mean, and yeah, like mid-Ohio really separates the men from the boys, I'm telling you, right now with the hairpin. And
yeah.
Yeah, and then that up and downhill. I mean, you can set up a really nice pass, but you really got to go for it and stick it. Otherwise, you're gonna regret it.
Yeah. Yeah, sounds like it.
But who's your racing idol?
My racing idol?
Yes.
Look, I've got a lot. Obviously, like everyone's idol, Ayrton Senna, right? And I just respect him so much for, like, what he's done and everything, the Schumacher. But, like, in recent times, for sure, it would have to be Scott Dixon for me. You know, like, obviously, he's a New Zealander. I race under the New Zealand banner as well.
Not on this show. There's only one correct answer on this show.
I'm sorry, Missy. Please forgive me.
Maybe.
But yeah, like Scott Dixon for sure would have to be, in terms of recent times and current times, I can't really go past Scott Dixon.
Yeah, she's saying that just because of, you know, it always seems like it's...
The correct answer is willpower.
There we go.
Willpower.
Willpower?
Yes, willpower.
Willpower as well is like a hero for me. You know, you can't go past him because... Do you want to hear a funny fact? Like, the first... No, this you'll like this, Missy. This might make you like not hate me. Like the first race I ever did, Will Power's dad was racing in the same race. So that's pretty cool.
Oh, that's awesome.
Oh wow, that is
cool. Yeah, Bob Power. He's a bit of a legend. I think I don't know age he is exactly, but like he's still like driving all the time and is just a legend around, you know, the Queensland area, obviously. So yeah, first ever race that I did, Will Power's dad was in, so it's kind of cool.
Did you beat him, or did he beat you?
I put on pole and won, so yeah, luckily I beat him. Otherwise, you know.
Nice. I mean, I guess you've learned pretty quickly that it's a lot easier to win from pole, right?
Oh, for sure. The worst thing, well, not worst thing, but the most ironic thing is I won my first ever National Formula Ford race from 18th place. I put it on pole, and how it worked was there's three races in a weekend. So it's Friday practice, qualifying, then race one on Saturday, then race two and race three on Sunday. So I put it on pole, and then race one, this is in 2017, I just made a mistake and, you know, long story short, I didn't finish the race. So I started 18th. And then I literally, my first win was from 18th on the grid. So, yeah, didn't really make it easy for myself. But once I won a race from pole, I was like, that was a lot easier than winning from 18th. So, yeah, I'd probably definitely try and be doing it like that rather than from 18th on the grid. But, yeah, definitely an easier way.
That's awesome. So, Missy, do you have any questions?
So when you do the Mazda Road to Indy Shootout, I guess just explain a little bit how it works, because it's not you're not just judged on your racing, correct?
So it's pretty like the shootout itself was like such a cool experience just to be there. Firstly, like you turn up, so how I turned up, obviously it was after Homestead, so I flew from Florida to Phoenix, and then we stayed. It's really nice. Really nice hotel, and there was a track walk on the Friday, and you kind of meet all the drivers, and it's different to a normal race weekend because there's a bit of like camaraderie. Well, I thought there was a little bit of camaraderie anyway, but it's still so intense because everyone knows what's at stake, right? Like it's literally a driver everyone's worked so hard for, and everyone deserves to be there. So Saturday, it's a Saturday and Sunday thing. So Saturday, there's three practice sessions, and then Sunday there's a morning practice session, and that's when it was cut to the six after the final practice session. And then the final six, we did a qualifying session with new tires and then a 30-minute race simulation. So there's a lot of off-track things as well, which are being judged on, which is, I think, obviously, you know, if you want to be a race car driver at the top of the, you know, the top of the echelon or the pinnacle, whatever you like to call it, you got to be the complete package, right? And Mazda, yeah, for sure, want to be sponsoring a driver who not only can do that, be the package on track, but, you know, just be just as impressive off track with sponsors and how you carry yourself and things like that. So, you know, that we had on the first night before we went to the on track kind of activities, I guess you could say, we met everyone from Mazda and had this big dinner, which was really cool. And then Saturday night, which was obviously the night before the last day, was a dinner with just us and the judges. So that was really cool as well. You know, it probably wasn't as formal as the first, you know, opening night dinner, but it was really cool just to, you know, speak to the judges about, you know, a bit of the stuff that they've done and things like that. So, you know, you're kind of constantly around the executives and a lot of people. So I wouldn't say, like, for me, I wasn't putting anything on. I was just being myself. And, you know, there's a lot of awesome people there to even just talk to and even learn off. Like Bob Bondurant, obviously, we're at the Bondurant School of Racing. So Bob and Pat Bondurant were there. And for me, meeting him was really cool because he's obviously done some amazing stuff. So, yeah, like I said, it's the on-track stuff was extremely intense. But, you know, off-track, yeah, there was so much stuff to kind of, you know, you can't really get out and just be, like you said, your attitude has to be good. So that was probably something that I've not put on. I definitely wouldn't say that. But, you know, you got to make sure that you got a good attitude at all times. So.
Yeah, that's definitely important. Rob Howden always said you have to have the three things, you know, and the on track talent's just one of the three. You know, you definitely have to be very marketable, but then and you have to be very fan friendly, and then obviously the talent on the track you also have to have. So
yeah, for sure.
But that's awesome, man. You're. It's just got to be such a huge confidence booster to going into, going into the season. have you talked to any teams yet, or has that been decided yet?
Nothing's been released or like officially confirmed. But you know, obviously, I've done some races. Some tests, the official tests with PAPS, and I really enjoyed that. So, like I said, nothing's been confirmed yet, but between Mazda and, you know, all my other supporters and things like that, I think hopefully we'll have something released soon. So.
Cape Motorsports. Oh, shit. Excuse me. 8 years in a row. Championship. Oh, sorry. I had a tickle.
That's all right. Happens all the time.
Sorry about that. But hey, you know, just, you know. Oh boy. Who did we have on last year? Was it Missy? He was arms up. I think he went with arms up. He was from Ireland, I believe.
Can't remember. Keith Donegan.
Yep.
That's Donegan. That's Keith Donegan.
Yep. We had Keith Donegan on last year before the season. And he was the scholarship winner, and he went with arms up. And I mean, we didn't say it on air. We just went, what? but yeah. I mean, like, you know, picking the right team is just so critical. It really is.
For sure.
And plus, I mean, the grid of drivers that you're gonna be racing against, you're gonna be racing against a lot of sophomores, obviously, and. It's probably going to be the most talented grid you've ever raced against, I'm sure. So, you know, so how you do, I guess, you know, if you do very well, then that speaks great volumes for your talent on track, you know. I mean, they say, like, you know, the big three things, but, you know, like, I mean, But as far as talent on the track, like that, like that's my biggest thing. Like, you know, like that, like that's what I like to focus on the most. You know, like then and not just like that kind of talent that you learn to have, that, you know, you just have like that natural kind of talent that you just kind of see when you're seeing it. I can't explain it,
yeah, 100%.
But
I know you know what I mean. I know
right?
what you mean.
Yeah. But
yeah, I know 100% what you mean.
Right on. But like, I mean, like, so basically, man, like, all I want to say is, you know, good luck to you for this upcoming season, and congratulations on winning the scholarship. I'm sure, you know, the judges, knowing who they were, you know, I'm sure they picked the right guy, and you know, no matter where you end up, it's still spec. So, you know, I mean, the cars aren't that much different than everybody else, but, you know, I think it really all comes down to the, you know, like, you know, what team just gels the most. I mean, because, I mean, Exclusive Autosport came in for their first season, and they won a lot of races, so, it, you know, a team that's been there for a while, or a new team, it really doesn't matter too much. I think it, I, you know, I mean, I'm sure you can attest to this, like, it's not just the driver, there's such a huge production behind, like that goes on behind you, that really has to click for everything to come together, right?
Yeah, 100%. Like, you gotta, to have, you know, success, it's obviously it's such a high level as well. You gotta have everything in your favor. Like, you know, you gotta have obviously a great team behind you, great support, and as a driver, you gotta make sure you've done everything in your power to obviously get that success. So, yeah, it's definitely not an easy thing, so that's what makes it so good.
Now, is there a certain racing style that you would consider yourself to be? Like, is there a certain racing style that you like? Do you like your car real loose, real tight, understeer, oversteer?
To be honest, like, I couldn't really say. Like, I said this in an interview once before the shootout. It was like going from a, you know, I got used to driving with a car that has no aero and a treaded tire. So going to the USF 2000 car where it had so much grip, I liked it so much. And in Australia, I probably tend to drive a car pretty loose. So that was something that I needed to work on, probably not driving it so sideways, but. You know, in the USF 2000 car, I'd say I'm probably still, you know, accustoming myself to it, I should say. So I probably couldn't say, you know, I drive a car like this or this. I'm just trying to adapt to it and learn as much as I can and, yeah, just keep on improving and just, yeah. I probably, at this moment, it's probably too early to say how, I probably don't even know how I'm driving the car at the moment. Like, I'm just trying to, like I said, just keep bettering myself, really.
Yeah, I mean, and the car is going to change throughout the race. So, I mean, the driver that can get the most out of the car, whether it's loose or tight, I think is going to win the race, right? So,
yeah, and 100%. Like, I think at the shootout, that was a big thing as well. A lot of the cars are probably set up a little bit different. And, you know, you had to adapt. Like, adapting was a pretty big part of the shootout, I think, speaking to the judges a little bit as well. And, you know, obviously everyone has their kind of personal kind of way of how they like the little car and the little intricacies and things like that. But, you know, at the end of the day, it was like, this is the car, you got to drive it. And that's it. So that was pretty fun. I enjoyed that a lot, actually. And noticing the differences between each car that they had at shootout. And I think, yeah. You know, you give a car to any top IndyCar driver and they'll find a way to make it go quick. So.
Yeah, and actually, that was kind of a trap question I gave you. I wanted to see how you'd answer that, and you answered exactly how I hope you would answer.
So, that's good then.
So you passed the test right there, because if you said I like it this way, then I was going to say, well, good luck, because it's not going to be that way all the time.
Yeah,
so, definitely.
Frank does that a lot, so you can be. Feel free to tell him you're not going to answer that.
Sweet. Well, that's probably the first time I've passed a test, to be honest, but no, nah, thanks.
Oh, there you go. There you go. And like the, it was just one of those questions where I was like, I wonder how he'll answer this because I really want to hear him answer it this way. And you did, and then that's a good thing. So, yeah.
Cool. Thanks, man.
Yeah, definitely. Missy, do you have any other questions?
That's not true at all. You passed the test of winning the Mazda Road to, any
I
scholarship
wasn't there.
shootout,
I wasn't the judge there. I'm judging him right now. No, I'm kidding. I'm kidding. I'm kidding. I'm kidding.
Now, speaking of, two of our good friends were judges, though, Ollie and Victor. So
Yeah,
we
Ollie and
put it we put
Victor.
in a good word.
They are Oliver and Victor. Obviously, they're two really accomplished drivers. Oliver obviously won it in 2016 and went on to win the championship the following year, which for me is obviously something that I'd love to replicate. But
Yeah, I think he
Victor as
won
well.
it for Cape Motorsports. I think he won it.
There you go. So and Victor as well. He's obviously won the Pro Mazda Championship, and just learning from those guys and seeing what they had to say. And even after I won it, it was so cool to kind of speak to them, and that was so nice to me and helped me with so much stuff. So they're real cool guys. And Tom Long and Andrew Carbonell, they were both judges as well. So they both did a mega job, or all four of them did an amazing job as coaches and judges. So.
Right on. Yeah, and like yeah, I mean, and they're just really good guys, and like I'm sure coming over, you didn't know what to expect, so I'm sure they made you feel like just calmed your nerves down pretty quickly, I'm sure.
Yeah, it was pretty nerve-wracking to be fair. Like I think I might have said this already, but it was such a intense environment at times because everyone wanted to win. It was like a career, I would basically life-changing, career-changing
Sure, sure.
opportunity that we were all competing for, and everyone that was there had won their right to be there. Every driver was a quick driver, and especially when we got to the top six, like everyone that was in that top six would have been a good pick. Like it was some really good guys. So that in itself was a really good experience for me, just to be around, so many quick drivers and meet so many guys. And yeah, I had a ton of fun in that aspect as well. So.
Yeah, I mean, honestly, like I think it was Kyle Kirkwood. He made it to the top six. He didn't win it, but I mean, he wound up winning the championship last year because, just the exposure that you get from being in that top six is very prestigious. And just look what Kyle Kirkwood was able to do with it. So,
If I remember correctly, I think he lost to Ollie.
no, he lost to Donegan.
No, Oliver won in 2016, I'm pretty sure. And I think that's when Kirkwood was there. I was speaking to Oliver about that.
Oh, Kirkwood. Oh, I'm sorry. Okay, but then, well, my point being is like somebody saw that he had, talent, and then 2017 picked him up and look what he did. So there you go. Or 2018. I'm sorry, 2018 season, because it's 2019 now. So last season, I'm all screwed up in the dates. Okay, there you go. So there. All I'm saying is, Kyle Kirkwood didn't win the scholarship yet. He still got a ride because he was there. But you see what I'm saying? That's all I'm trying to say.
Yeah.
All right. So
I
yeah.
get you, man. I get you.
Thanks for being on my side, Hunter.
That's all right. That's, I'm just I'm
You're
still trying to
back in
make you
my
not
good
hate me,
graces
remember?
now. Yeah,
Sweet,
see, you're
sweet.
back in my good graces now.
That's all I was trying to do, really,
It worked.
Right on. So, Missy, do you have any questions right now? Or do you want to try to I don't know, was there I'm stumbling over here. I'm sorry. Missy, save me.
I'm enjoying watching you drown.
Yeah, no kidding.
No, I don't think so. I think we covered it. Mostly everything.
So, if we'll how about this, Hunter? If there's anything that you would like to say, Going into this upcoming 2019 USF 2000 season, the number one thing on your mind, what would it be?
To be honest, I'd probably just like to thank Mazda, firstly, the whole road to Indy, and Anderson Promotions, and everyone that's made it possible for me to be here. It's such a for me. I'm so excited just to get this opportunity, and I'll definitely be, it's like I said, it's so many talented drivers, and it's going to be extremely tough competition. But I'll do everything that I can to do the best possible job that I can do, and yeah, I'm just. So excited to be part of it, and yeah, really want to thank everyone. Like I said, Mazda, Road to Indy, Anderson Promotions, and yeah, just all my supporters made it possible for me to be here.
Right on. Perfect. Couldn't have said it better myself. Right on, man. So if you don't mind, we'll take about 10 minutes, catch up with the latest news that's going on in the world of Road to Indy and IndyCar, feel free to give your opinion on anything and everything that's been going on, man.
No worries.
Consider yourself a guest co-host, though. We don't really we don't really consider anybody who comes on the show guests. We consider them guest hosts. So,
Damn. I
honestly,
don't know if I'm ready for this responsibility, but I'll try.
So the spotlight's on you. So go,
Here we go.
Hunter, go. So what happened this week? I'm kidding. Missy, any news that's gone on since last time we were talking?
Just the only thing, IndyCar COTA is going to be open to the public. They will be there for 2 days. I believe it is February 12th and 13th. There will be a preseason test there. So again, it is open to the public. So go out, anyone out there in COTA, go show your love for IndyCar. It will be. The track will be open from 9 a.m. to 5 p.m. on Tuesday, to the public. So there you go.
Right
And
on.
then also, the other thing was the TV. IndyCar reveals the TV schedule for 2019.
Yeah, you'll never guess the races will be on NBC. I'm shocked.
Yes, I know. Every race is on and some form of NBC.
Yeah, I mean, either NBC Sportsnet or NBC itself.
Or NBC.
A lot of races are going to be on prime time and NBC channel. I was happy to see that. Not just Indy. It's going to be Detroit. It's going to be. I don't have it pulled up here. I miss it. Do
You mean NBC you're talking about?
Yeah, that's kind of like people with a.
All of the 500, the road course,
Kind of a big deal when it's just on NBC, not NBC Sportsnet.
yeah, so the IndyCar Grand Prix, in Indianapolis will be on NBC. The Indianapolis 500 will be on NBC for the first time in a long time, I guess. It's been on ABC for a while, and then Detroit, both races are going to be on NBC. Road America is going to be on NBC. Mid-Ohio will be on NBC, and then the last two races of the year, Portland and Laguna Seca, will be on NBC.
Portland was a great race. I mean, MRTI, IndyCar was. I thought it was a great race. It was a great. I thought it was a great event for the first year.
It looks such a good track too. Like the racing is pretty cool. Like at turn one, there were so many moves,
Oh,
so
was
many like
there?
pretty big moves. Like I remember the Indy Lights race.
Yeah, what was
I
Herta
forget.
thinking?
I forget the drive. I don't. I can't remember the drivers exactly, but like I think it was teammates. And they were thrown down. Like it was cool to watch.
Yeah, it was I know Franzoni was involved in it, and Herta just chopped the entire field down. I don't know what he was thinking. And Pato was just hanging back like, I already won this thing, guys. You do what you do. And then I'm gonna and then after this I'm gonna check out and win this thing by 29 seconds. Peace.
Yeah, that's always nice when you can like win like by a massive gap. That's always a cool feeling. Yeah. But
when you've already won the championship and you really don't even need to.
Yeah, that's that. Cool.
Yeah,
he won it. Hey, Paso Award won it. Yeah, he did a real good job in that IndyCar race at Sonoma, I think it was, right?
Yeah. I mean, you know, I'm telling you, you know, obviously the Dixon Power rivalry and Rossi pretty much has thrown himself in the mix there. So you know that whole rivalry, you know, going that's it's been a lot of fun to watch, but the Pato and the Rosenquist, rivalry is going to be really fun to watch because I personally think that they're two of one of the most talented young drivers that belong in the top tier racing league right now. So you know, Pato and Felix Rosenquist right now. I'm really looking forward to them going at it.
Yeah, Rosenquist is like he's driven almost everything, that guy. He's so quick. Like I'm pretty sure everything he's driven, he's pretty much won in. So
yeah, I mean,
he'll be cool to watch.
Yeah, I mean, in Blanc, Spain, he won with Tristan Vautier in the Endurance Championship, and we can't say it enough, you know, Tristan Vautier, big shout out to him, world champion, GT winner 2018, the most literal trophy I've ever seen in my life. World champion, and it's literally a globe on top of the trophy. That's hysterical, but
that's cool.
Yeah,
I was speaking to Johnny Baker. You know Johnny Baker. He did work for Pelfrey, and he works with the Road Indy now. He's been real. I've caught up with him a few times. He's a real good dude, and you know, he's been around racing for the American racing scene for a while. And he was telling me about he worked with Tristan, and he said, yeah. He couldn't, you know, he had nothing bad to say about him at all. So, obviously, I haven't met him yet, but he sounds like a pretty good dude and a good driver.
Yeah, Tristan's the man, man. I mean, you know, I'm sure Tristan will be at St. Pete. He was there last year, so yeah, I'll try to get him to, try to get him over have him meet you, man. Really good dude. Yeah, we've been friends with Tristan since 2012, was it, Miss? Right, 2012, I think.
Yeah. Sounds about right. Yeah.
Yeah, I was just texting.
Nice.
I was just texting with him the other day. So, because he's gonna be racing in the Daytona 24. You know, he's got a full time ride with a DPI team. I don't remember the team exactly. Right off the top of my head, because don't really care too much about him. So, but anyway, you know, but I do care about all of our guys that are, you know, filling in and filling in the extra seats they need. Even you know, guys like, you know, Aaron Tielitz is going to be racing too. So you know, that's what I mean. Like so many good drivers that are open wheelers that are. You know, going to be in that race, so definitely, you know, if you have the means to watch it, Hunter, on IMSA.com, the 224, you know.
A lot of it's going to be on NBC, too.
Yeah, for sure.
What's that?
A lot of the races are going to be on NBC, too.
Oh, right on. Cool.
That's a cool race. That's definitely a race that I'd love to do one day. Like, yeah, such a cool race, so.
I mean, I have no doubts that, yeah, I'm sure you'll be asked. Probably next
that'd,
year.
I would jump at it, so.
Or, I mean, like, you know, since, you know, you'll probably be asked for Sebring, who knows? There you go.
That'd be cool.
Okay, so then other than the TV broadcast schedule, missing anything else? Because I didn't really see anything myself.
No, there wasn't really too much news besides the TV schedule coming out with set times for all the races and everything. So I think there's going to be three night races this year. Texas is going to be a night race. Iowa is going to be a night race. race in Gateway is going to be a night race.
Yeah, Gateway was such a great race last year.
I like the night races.
That'll be cool. That'll be cool to watch. They look cool, the sparks and everything.
Mm-hmm.
Definitely. You know what? So,
I'm glad Iowa's back to a night race, actually.
Yeah, I think Iowa was really suffering as far as attendance goes, because it was hot the last 2 years. Oh, my God. I was like, thank God for this media. Oh, nice air conditioning.
Yeah, all the night races are on Saturdays, so.
Right on. And we still haven't heard of a main sponsor title, whatever thing.
No, but we have been promised that in the next coming weeks, I believe, if I heard correctly.
I mean, I haven't even...
Before the end of January, I keep hearing, but...
I haven't even heard, a hint of anything. Like, they've been keeping the lid on... I mean, Hunter, you hear anything?
Yeah. About the IndyCar sponsor?
Yeah.
No, I couldn't tell you anything, but the one thing I have been hearing heaps of, talk about is IndyCar coming back to the Gold Coast, so...
Ah, yeah, so there's 2020, did I say, possibly?
Awesome. There's a lot of talk. Surfers there's
paradise.
A lot of talk, so...
I forget, who got the pole in the win the last time they were there? I forget who it was. Every time Will gets a pole, we all joke around. And we say how many poles he really has, but with the asterisk, you know, because Surfers Paradise really didn't count because it was an exhibition. But
really? That not count?
It did not
No.
count. No, that race didn't count.
That was just a non-points race.
See, what it was is when IndyCar split, you know, because, you know, back in the late 90s when, you know, they were run by idiots. And, you know,
no way.
They were money-hungry fools. So they split, and then, you know, all the, and then, yeah. So when the two seasons were over and they were joined and they were merging back together to, I guess, to showcase what the new series will be like, to look like, and all the drivers, they all went to Surfers Paradise. And that was like the exhibition race of, you know, the new IndyCar series. You know what I mean?
Yeah, that was an unreal, event, like,
oh, great race.
And
I remember watching
as it. I'm like in like right now at home where I am, it's like 10 minutes away, 10-15 minutes away, like literally to where they were, and you could hear it from your house. Like, not that I was at home when it was there, but yeah, like you could literally hear the cars screaming.
That's awesome.
So yeah, it was real cool.
Well, they'll be by your house again, and I guess what, next year then, right?
Hopefully. Hopefully, right? Like, there's a lot of talk, and like a few guys like I know of who kind of, you know, have friends in the higher places or whatever you want to call it. Like, there's this is seriously possible. So it'd be so cool. Like, I'd love that.
And Will Power was there talking it up because
yeah,
he's
Will
Australian.
I mean,
yeah, there you go.
I'm pretty sure it's going to happen because, I mean, you know, Mark Miles and Will could, I mean, not Will, because he, you know, obviously he can just be going home, but Mark Miles was there with him too, and I don't think Mark Miles is going to jump on a plane and fly halfway around the world just to have a talk. I mean, he can do that from his office, so,
yeah,
you know,
yeah.
I think it's pretty much in the bag that Surfers Paradise is going to be back, you know.
Hopefully, like, man, it would be so cool, so.
Yeah, definitely.
Hopefully.
Well, you know what? I just want to say, Hunter, thank you for coming on, man. It's been a pleasure.
Thank you, guys. Thank you.
Yep, definitely, man, definitely. And before we let you go, we always, since you're a new driver to the show, and hopefully not the first time, this will be the first of many times, you know, that you'll be in the show, and obviously we'll be, Miss, you'll be interviewing you at the track, you know, way after you're on the podium and everything.
Sweet.
So I'm going to hand off to Missy. There's two questions we always ask new drivers, and they're the most two important questions you'll ever be asked in your
life.
All right,
pressure's on.
Yes, it
pressure's on, then.
So I'm going to hand it over to Missy, and I just want to say again, thank you for coming on, Hunter.
No, thanks again for having me. It's been real fun.
Oh, before the first two questions, you want to throw out your social media so the fans could know where to follow you out?
Sure. So literally, it's just my first name and last name. So just Hunter McElrea. My last name's a bit difficult to spell, so it's just Hunter, McElrea. So that's kind of on everything. So it's kind of easy. So yeah, thanks.
Right on. And guys, you can also go into the show notes, and his name and Twitter handle and everything will be right there as well. So there you go. All right, Missy, floor is yours.
So, Hunter, first question. What keeps you most comfortable in the car in regards to your gloves and your boots? Do you have a favorite brand?
What keeps me most comfortable? I have to, like, so basically, you're asking me for my favorite brand of race gear, right?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay. At the moment, I would have to say Sparco, extremely good. And this year, I'm lucky enough to be wearing Sparco. So, yeah, really loving that Sparco gear.
Good choice. And then second question is, in regards to your boots, do you prefer a harder or softer sole?
A hard or soft sole? Well, I guess you can say this in two ways. I don't like a thick sole. Like, I like having good feel for pedal. And I guess a soft sole would probably mean you have more feel with the pedal. So, yeah, soft sole will have
Standing
to
ovation. We finally got a driver that says soft soul.
Like, not like bend, like not like terribly soft, right? But like, I like feeling the pedal. So yeah, that's my reasoning.
No, it's literally like what we missed, like the last five drivers at least, they've all said harder souls. I don't know why. Because for the longest time it was always like open wheel drivers, softer soul because they want to feel the pedals, and then harder soul for the sports car guys because obviously it gets hot in there and you don't want your foot to be burning up, you know.
Yeah.
So yeah, but definitely, yeah. But the last couple of open wheelers, they all had said harder sole, and I'm like, oh, okay. And I was like, well,
Damn.
maybe my thinking on this was off. But congratulations, you're bringing it back, man. Bringing the average back.
Sweet.
Right
Thank you.
on, Hunter.
I feel a lot more relaxed now that that's over with. Let me tell you, that was some pretty stressful stuff.
I mean,
I never any harder questions.
Hunter, I mean, I was stressful listening to it and waiting for the answers myself. And I wasn't even being asked. So,
There you go.
I was
Exactly.
right there with
Frank's not allowed to ask the questions anymore.
Really?
He started out asking the questions, but he was banned from asking them anymore when he was interviewing Dion von Moltke.
Damn.
Yes, and asked him what keeps him most comfortable in the car.
No, I just said so what do you like so or no I
So
said
what do you wear?
so what are you wearing? That's all I said. And he was like, what, like right
Damn.
now? And I'm like, no, in the car, in the car. Yeah,
That
I suck.
was pretty, yeah, I don't know if it was a trick question or what, to be honest, but yeah,
Uh,
the suspense was pretty high, pretty high.
our We our old co-host Jay came up with the two questions, and we just kind of kept it going in his honor. So
There
yep.
you go. Perfect.
Oh yeah. Again, really enjoyed having you on, man. It was a lot of fun getting to know you, and really looking forward to meeting you in person at St. Pete. And you're gonna love it there. Beautiful track, beautiful area. And even though it's March, but you're from Australia, so you should be used to the excruciating sun. So
There we go.
yeah.
Thanks, guys, again. Thank you.
Right on. And Missy, on that note.
And before we do that, and as always, you can find our stuff at www.theindiesportscarpodcast.com. And also, you can find Christian's book, My Life and Story, The Outside Groove, at Amazon.com. Books and No, oh, I messed this all up.
Amazon.com, Walmart.com, Books a Million.
Books a Million, and other fine retailers. There you go. So, and on that note,
That was a lot.
I know. I have to remember a lot. Usually he spits out all the other ones that I spit out and other fine retailers. And then now, on that note, you know that I know that Frank, he knows this time. And now, Hunter, he knows St. Pete is in 57 days, 1 hour, 21 minutes, and 8 seconds. Yep.